We're delighted to have you here. It's a wonderful crowd. We're looking forward to the talk, Mary, and the spirit of dialogue, which will certainly accompany it. A couple of just notes from the very beginning, so I get out of the way. One is, in a significant way, I would very much like to thank our sponsors, the Center for Ethics and Education, the Department of Philosophy, and the Wisconsin Center for Education Research. And I would like to just briefly note that we will be having some WISCAPE events in the very near future. It's a forum on a very, very important topic, and that is the future of K-16 education in Wisconsin, which we're hosting on April 26th to 1 to 4 p.m. at the Hilton Garden. So if you're interested, please pick up a flyer, because I think we have some here. Now let me turn, if I could, and introduce Professor Harry Brighouse, a very esteemed philosopher in the Department of Philosophy at UW-Madison, and his book with Michael McPherson, former president of McAllister College, and now the at the foundation. A couple of things I'd like to say. I've read the book. I've had it personally autographed, and I enjoyed it very much. If I may take the liberty of saying, I'm someone who struggled with trying to figure out the aims and purposes of the higher learning for about 40 years. And I could still continue to struggle with it, but I think this is an important contribution. And I think one of the propositions, if I can also say so, that I particularly appreciate it, is a proposition that our universities, both in their structure and their faculty and the everyday fabric of the of our colleges and universities, should model justice. That's a rather evocative idea, I think, as someone who's been to hundreds and hundreds of universities across the United States and the world. Briefly, I'll just say very briefly, aims of education. Harry will do it, but Harry Brighouse and McPherson bring together some very leading philosophers, not least including Amy Gutman, who wrote that classic book on democracy and education back in 1987. And so there are a lot of different arguments over some of the, a little bit on finance and how they should be run, what their contributions are. But I think what particularly struck me is that they do sometime in the book address issues related to moral justice and the political value. So it's quite a pleasure for me to introduce our speaker for today and join. Very much look forward to his comments and our dialogue that will surely follow. So, Harry, welcome. Good to have you here.
I understand, because there are all these people around the side, if I sit, I can't see their faces. I know they probably don't care whether they can see mine, but I do care whether I can see theirs. Oh, thanks very much to WISCAPE for setting this up, inviting me to do it. I'm going to talk about three different things. So the first is, I'm just going to talk a little bit about why we did the book that we did. This is, in fact, the only visual aid I have. There's the book. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about three contributions to the book. So it's an edited volume. There are seven or eight contributions, depending on how you count. One thought was that I could spend 3 minutes on each contribution and then you'd know what was in the book, but that just seems stupid to me. So what I thought I'd do is talk a little bit about three contributions, sort of give you enough to make you interested in reading the book, but not enough that you don't feel you need to read it, basically. And then I'm going to end with a discussion of some issues that aren't discussed in the book. So in the final chapter is entitled Future Research on Values in Higher Education. So I'm taking the excuse of the fact that we wrote the final chapter that elaborates a whole set of questions that didn't get discussed in the book to try and get you to think about some of those questions. So let me just talk a bit first about the motivation for the book. So it's a component of a much larger project that Michael McPherson and I have been working on for about 10 years now. The Center for Ethics and Education is sort of a continuation of. where what we're trying to do is promote high quality philosophical work in education. In the last sort of 35 years, philosophers and health researchers have worked together thinking and developing a large and very healthy field. My colleague Dan Hausman is a major contributor to it, which I think of as roughly philosophy of health and health policy. Very high quality philosophers, not least Dan, working in the field. They feel accountable to talking to people who are social scientists and institutional leaders in health and health research. And they get listened to. Every major hospital has a philosopher in it. Every major hospital has an ethics committee. First thing, if you're like me and you come to a philosophy department to teach moral political philosophy in a school that has medical school attached to it, sometime in the first year and a half, somebody from the medical school comes to you and says, come and give us a talk. And you say, I don't know anything about medicine or health. And they say, doesn't matter. Come and give us a talk. We will induct you. So the idea was, education just doesn't have that kind of culture. It doesn't have that kind of resource. And the Spencer Foundation has put a lot of time, energy, and effort, and money into trying to develop a similar kind of resource, a similar kind of field with respect to education. K-12 and higher. How do we do this? So what we wanted to do, the way we've gone about it, is sort of twofold. We've invested in younger scholars, giving them incentives to work on the kinds of education questions that we want to see more work on. And we've sort of dangled in front of them the fact that we can get more senior scholars, the kind of scholars they admire and respect and want to be like, to do work on that. What we can induce them into doing work on those issues as well. The book was, what we did was we invited seven people that we really admired, and I think I'm right that we invited only seven, because we thought we wanted seven contributions. We made a list of 14, and the first seven said yes. So we didn't have to go further down the list. And we asked them to write, we gave them a reading list, quite an elaborate reading list, and we said, we want you to read a good deal of this stuff. Here's a set of questions. We gave them about 20 questions that we thought would be worth working on. And we said, tell us what you come up with. We'll bring you over, we'll bring you all together twice. We brought them together once for a couple of days to workshop their papers together, and we brought them a second time to do the conference. And they and then we worked on getting them to get the books, the work into shape for a book. I will say about Amy Gutman, we invited her thinking she'll turn us down, and she didn't, and also thinking there's no way she'll give us a paper, she'll just give us a nice talk, and that'll be great, but we won't be able to use it. And about halfway through her talk, I turned to Mike and said, she's written this out, you know, we can ask her to give this to us as a chapter, and indeed she did. Okay, so I'll say something about three of the chapters, three of the contributions. The first two, all three are about the aims of higher education. But the first two are by Amy Gutman, and who many people know as the president of the University of Pennsylvania, and Chris Bertram, who's a professor at Bristol University in the UK. And they eloquently highlight a problem, an institutional phenomenon that will be familiar to maybe not everyone in the room, but a lot of people in the room, and which we think is going to become more kind of pronounced and severe over time. So over the past decade or so, we've seen from legislators, parents, and students increasing anxiety over the role of undergraduate education in promoting economic development, and an accompanying shift in choices that undergraduates make in terms of their majors, from what you might think of as sort of classical liberal arts education majors to more professional, vocationally oriented majors. And education in the liberal arts disciplines are understandably threatened by the resource implications within higher education of this shift. Defenders of the liberal arts also worry that various goods that are not easily captured in economic language may be vulnerable to these choices. The liberal arts, including the most threatened component of the liberal arts, the humanities, the thought goes, contribute something to the, something vital to the health of the arts, the richness of our democracy, the cultural and civic fabric of our society. And if we weaken the liberal arts, we weaken ourselves. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Chris Bertram's take on the humanities. This is just a little window into his thinking. It's the thing I found most interesting probably in his paper. He offers reasons to be more optimistic than lots of the doomsayers are about the robustness of our culture, even in the face of all students deciding they don't want to take humanities majors. He points out that we're in the first, I think it is the first golden age of American and apparently of Danish television. Maybe it's not the first golden age of Danish television, I don't know, but certainly of American. So The Wire, Breaking Bad, Deadwood, they are the modern equivalents of the Russian novel, right? And whereas television used to be ephemeral, its products are now as permanent and readily available to new generations as those Russian novels, and without the confusing names. They're also far more widely consumed, at least than those novels are. But recent analyses have also shown sort of that the working vocabulary of Eminem, who I believe is a hip-hop artist, is greater than that of Bob Dylan and the Beatles combined. The democracy-based argument for preserving humanities in universities only gets us so far. Basically, there's a lot of this stuff, and a lot of it gets consumed. I'm really struck by, so there are a lot of young people in the room, the kind of access and engagement they have with poetic lyrics is unparalleled in the whole history of humanity. You guys, you wake up in the morning and you listen to a poem. The thought that you could get hold of the music you wanted to listen to, or even the music you didn't want to listen to when I was a kid, I mean, you had to go to great lengths. Now, going to those great lengths was a lot of fun, but it was not engagement in poetry, right? You have lost that fun, but you get the engagement in poetry. What Bertram argues, just to encapsulate it in a single sentence, is that you're not going to get an argument for more humanities majors by talking about the value of the humanities to democracy. What you're going to get an argument, how you're going to get an argument for making the humanities healthy in the university, is by thinking about the hermeneutic and analytical methods of knowledge acquisition that are distinctive to the humanities. And it can yield knowledge that is valuable for its own sake, as well as for its contribution to our cultural and civic fabric. All right, so that's Chris. So now let's talk a bit about Amy Gutman. I'm very conscious of time. I want to leave plenty of time for you to discuss things with me, and I also want to leave plenty of time for me to say the outrageous things I'm going to say toward the end of the talk, so I'll make sure I do that. So Amy Gutman's approach to the challenges facing the liberal arts is quite different, and I really wanted to highlight this in the talk because I think she sets a challenge for people in the liberal, professors in the broadly speaking liberal arts, especially at research universities. She thinks that the distinction between the liberal arts education and a vocational and professional education that emerged in the middle part of the 19th century, driven very substantially by the efforts of Charles Eliot, who was a sort of pioneering leader of Harvard University, was a mistake. And it was maybe a really, really terrible mistake. She adopts the view, funnily enough, of the founder of her own university, Benjamin Franklin, I think some people have heard of him, which is that because life is short and higher education is shorter, all students should be taught only what is most beautiful and what is most useful. In other words, everybody should get a liberal arts education and a professional education, and we shouldn't be hiving each off into their own separate pathways. This has profound implications for what an ideal higher education would look like, and for how defenders of the liberal arts should strategize to stem, that is not a joke, the decline in enrollments. It is a joke. Something first about the ideal higher education. It's fine for someone to major in accounting and fine for someone to major in philosophy. But the professional schools do students or education. But the professional student schools do students a serious disservice if they set up the curriculum in a way that means that business majors or accounting majors or education majors do not get, either through their business courses or through classes they're required to take elsewhere, philosophical or humanities-related education. Perhaps more uncomfortably, the College of Arts and Science does the philosophy major a disservice if they don't ensure that she also acquires some sort of acquaintance with the professional life or the kind of professional life that either she will pursue or that many of her peers and the people she's going to live in society with eventually are going to pursue. So that's the kind of education that we now think about how to strategize. And when I say strategize, I mean strategize from the point of view maybe of humanities. I was on a committee a couple of years ago in Letters and Science about how to improve the standing of the humanities. It was like a secret, I shouldn't have told you this, it was like a secret cabal in which we were, okay, can you edit that, please? Should those of us in the humanities be seeking to compete for majors? Well, you know, maybe to some extent. But much more urgently for the students, we should be working to induce accounting majors to take, not to stop being accounting majors, but to take some humanities courses. And make sure that those courses enrich their educations by providing them with the personal and intellectual resources that we think are distinctively provided through our disciplines. And this is something I did bang on about, I think people got tired, but in that committee, the secret committee that you're not supposed to know about. If we're going to make the promise of teaching the humanities, we have to actually make the courses worth taking. Right? We have to actually deliver them in a way that really gives that education, that it isn't just them checking a box because they have to take a bloody humanities course or a philosophy course or whatever. But that we have to really, our pedagogy has to include them. It has to be designed to ensure that they really learn the stuff that we think it's so valuable for them to learn. Otherwise, we should just pack up and go home or become business professors. Which in my case means to pack up and go home. this thought leads me to the contribution that I know, it's the one contribution that I know has been widely read, at least in philosophy departments, by instructors, and that's the chapter by Kyla Eagles Duggan called Autonomy as an Intellectual Virtue. So what Eagles Duggan does in that paper is she turns around a large philosophical literature about autonomy as an intellectual goal. And that large philosophical literature kind of takes the problem this way. It says, look, what you have is you've got all these children who are raised in traditionalist, maybe religious, probably conservative households, and they arrive at school or at college, and our job as educators is to distance themselves from received unconsidered opinions and give them the intellectual resources to reflect on those opinions, to become autonomous. So the problem is you've got these conservative students who haven't ever thought about anything, and now we make them think about everything. A colleague of mine who was a, I won't name him, but I have edited a volume with him. A colleague of mine who was a dean of the faculty at a very fancy liberal arts college once said to a group of parents, incoming freshman parents, our job is to take your kids when they come here as freshmen and make sure that when they come home for Thanksgiving, they've questioned everything that you've taught them. Apparently he was not particularly popular with his provost after that. Eagles Duggan says, look, that's not the real scenario. That's not, she says she teaches at Northwestern, that's not recognizable from her experience. The problem she encounters with students is not that they come in with sort of deep, you know, deep religious or whatever traditional commitments that are unswayable, but they come in way, way too ready to criticise anything and everybody. They read the literature that they read and they say, oh, this is what's wrong with this, this is what, they have enormous intellectual self-confidence and they have a kind of, they're too ready to assume that finding a problem with what they've read permits them to walk away from it. Rather than, for example, taking the discovery of an objection as a prompt to reconstruct. Autonomy is not, she thinks, simply destructive. Autonomy is an intellectual virtue, requires humility, patience, charity, and respect. And the professor who encounters those students who lack those virtues needs to focus on making them develop them, not developing critical distance from their own views. What I liked about Evelyn Stuggan's paper, among other things, is her insistence on understanding that different kinds of institutions have different kinds of problems. So the experience, I broadly agree with Evelyn Stuggan's sort of view about what autonomy really is like as an intellectual virtue. But I don't have the same experience. I don't have either of the experiences that she describes. I don't have the experience when I teach freshmen of them coming in ready to criticize everything. I also don't have them coming in totally wedded to unreflective views. Instead, my students, I think, by and large, die out with too much humility. They, for the first time in their lives, in most cases, reading high-quality, persuasive prose. They weren't allowed to read that in high school. They had to read stories. And they tend to agree with whatever they read, believing, to quote a particular person who I'm looking around is not actually in this room but could easily be, these people writing are really smart. Who am I to criticize them? Personally, I find her characterization of, autonomy entirely compelling, but the pedagogical task of developing that virtue in students who are excessively intellectually humble, which describes a good number of my students, is quite different. From the task of developing it in students who suffer, as my father-in-law puts it, a surfeit of self-esteem, which I think is too many of her students. Okay, good, I'm going through things. So what I'm going to do now is turn to, as I say, in the final chapter, what we did is we set out a long list, I don't know, there are 10, 12, 13 items on it, of questions that we don't think that we really want philosophers to think about a lot more and to be writing about, and crucially to be writing in a way that is engaged with the professional community and maybe even the community of parents and of students in higher ed. And so I'll give you some of these. I've cheated a little bit and I've added something to the list that isn't in the book, but I hope you'll forgive me on that. First, actually, is, you know, although it's called the aims of higher education, and although that is something that troubles people a lot, philosophers in my tradition have not addressed that question very much, what the aims of higher education should be. There's plenty of resources from people who are not technically philosophers, somebody like Derek Bock, who was wrote a wonderful book called Our Underachieving Colleges, which elaborates a story about what higher education should be like without ever defending it. What it should be about. Or Stanley Fish, who was for a long time a dean at the University of Illinois, Chicago, who gives this extraordinarily different, box picture is there are many, many different kind of aims. We should have a very rich, liberal kind of education, and I'm going to be a bit crude here in describing Fish, but Fish says basically we should teach the academic disciplines and absolutely nothing else ever. And if they don't listen, that's their problem. Right? We are essentially performers of our disciplines, and we should be passing those disciplines down and along. I'm not going to take a position here on which of those is more right. But what's striking is that neither of them, these are both very influential views and influential things, but neither of them have a kind of foundational philosophical background set of arguments for them. And that debate, I think, would be enriched by the work of good, attentive, nuanced philosophers. So the second thing is, what the purposes are of higher education has implications for how professors and other teachers should think of their jobs. So Stanley Fish says this. He says, I'm trained and paid to do two things. Needless to say, I don't always succeed in my attempts to do them. One, to introduce students to materials they don't know a whole lot about. And two, to equip them with the skills that will enable them first to analyze and evaluate those materials, and second, to perform independent research should they do so after the semester is over. That's it. That's the job. There's nothing more. Now, that seems absolutely right to me if the proper aim of higher education is the one that he says it is. But if we have a much richer kind of conception of what higher education should be, that it should be there to produce people who are going to make real sort of serious contributions to the society they enter, then our job maybe should look quite different from the way he describes it. So perhaps professors should, for example, be trained in basic counseling techniques. Maybe we should be trained how to craft an email to a student who's not been coming to class in such a way that it makes them want to come back to class without feeling chided or criticized. Maybe we should just learn how to be taught how to craft an email which isn't kind of asshole-ish and off-putting. All those things, I'm totally in favor of people writing emails like that to people they already know, but not to their students, really. By the way, I've never been taught how to do that. And I would say, I don't think I do that, but I think I waste a lot of time trying to figure out how to write emails in a way that will work and that is sensible and that is not too pushy and is not too forgiving. Maybe we should be taught something about how to approach students who we can see are withdrawn and depressed and need help. And the thing I would most like to learn how to do is how to, this is funny, I once had a student who I was really trying to get her to go and see a counsellor because she needed to. And at a certain point, she just looked at me and she said, if I wanted to see a counsellor, why would I be here talking to you? I thought, right, I'm totally fucked up. I don't know how to do that. Third issue. Professors have got a lot of choice. Professors at an institution like this have a lot of choices about how they spend their time. Basically, everybody I know works amazing numbers of hours, works really hard, but a lot of the time we spend is time that we spend doing what we want to do. I spend a lot of time in committees. At first, it's because I felt some kind of obligation to do it, but increasingly, it's because I kind of enjoy it. So basically, I sort of think, yeah, if I really felt an obligation to do something else, I would do that instead of what I enjoy, I think. But think about it this way. So you have choice over even what you research. Some topics for research are more socially valuable than others. It's really hard for me to believe that the probable marginal social benefit of a new essay on the portrayal of tea drinking in the Victorian novel is the same as that of a new study of the effects of teaching Victorian literature in a particular way to 11th graders. Or adding a voluntary discussion section for secondary ed English majors to one's Victorian literature class. By voluntary, I mean one that one, as the teacher, voluntarily teaches without being paid. The literature scholar, of course, has a specific skill set, but that skill set is not fixed. He can learn new research methods that may be better suited to investigating more socially pressing issues, or learn new ways of teaching Victorian literature or to prospective or current high school English teachers. Similarly, our choices about how to spend our time on research relative to teaching. So here's the top. I don't know what the answer to this is, how we ought to be thinking about that. But suppose we thought that in a kind of institution like ours, teaching and research should be roughly co-equal for various reasons. If that's right, one of the things you would expect was that if you went to any average professor and you said, of the last 10 conferences you've been to, how many have been, have you gone to aim to improve your instructional skills and relative to how many you've gone to improve your research skills? And my guess is if you did ask that of the average professor at UW-Madison, the average professor would say fewer than five. was on the instructional research story. And those that didn't say that are either exceptional or liars. The question here, which I'm then going to move into, and this will be my last one, another aspect of, is it's really about professional ethics. It's about, we are a profession without a very well elaborated professional ethic. Our professional ethic doesn't tell us much about how to think about what to do with our discretionary time, how to make these choices. I sort of think that professors understand they shouldn't murder or sleep with their students, plagiarize or fake results, or criticize their colleagues' teaching, though not necessarily in that order. And notice that whereas murdering a student is well understood to be off limits, it may not be so widely understood that murdering a colleague is problematic. But that's a pretty thin ethic. And I don't think that's enough, given the daily decisions we make about how to use our time. Okay, so I'm going to just finish with a final question about faculty ethics, which I think should hit close to home, given recent events here. So generally, we've regarded much faculty speech beyond the academy as protected by academic freedom. But now think about expression on publicly accessible social media. So I'm talking about blogs, I'm talking about, well, now all newspapers are publicly accessible. I guess Facebook to some extent, and Twitter. So a colleague at Madison made several inflammatory tweets. Is that what they're called? Tweets? It sounds ridiculous. Is it deliberate? Do they call it that because it sounds ridiculous? I don't know. During the killing of the police officers in Dallas last summer, and at least one of those tweets was easily interpretable as celebrating those murders. A couple of years ago, the University of Illinois withdrew a job offer from Stephen Salata, a professor who had tweeted as follows. I'm going to read out three most apparently problematic tweets. Zionists, transforming anti-Semitism from something horrible into something honorable since 1948. And then there's a hashtag and hashtags. I repeat, if you're defending hashtag Israel right now, then hopelessly brainwashed is your best prognosis. Let's cut to the chase. If you're defending Israel right now, you're an awful human being. Now look, such speech is clearly constitutionally protected. But is it consistent with the professional role of educators whose job is to educate all comers, as it were? So just as a Muslim student might find it difficult to learn from a professor whose public statements appear to condemn Muslims as potential terrorists, I think I might find that difficult. Mightn't a Jewish student with strong Zionist sympathies find it difficult to learn from a professor whose public proclamations express contempt for all Zionists, or to consider a case that arose recently, the same case, the offspring of a police officer, or somebody just aspiring to become a police officer, which some of my students are, find it difficult to learn from a professor whose public statements appear to celebrate the murder of police officers? If you teach at a private school, maybe you don't have to worry about this question as much as if you teach at a public school. But your obligations if you teach at a public flagship, especially, which markets itself as a uniquely affordable, high-quality option for middle-class and working-class in-state students seeking social mobility, may be different. I think it really might be different. Our obligations here might be different than if we were at Harvard. Social media and the internet have made it much more difficult for us to keep separate our political activism, such as it is, from our teaching persona. And if somebody comes to your house and babysits, and they see the political sign on your house, you might have to point out to them that that's your wife and not you. I don't know, just to say something that happened to me last week. I hope you don't have the picture in the text, do you? She received the picture, she didn't get it. Now, I wouldn't want to suggest the faculty should refrain from any online activity that be inappropriate in an open and inclusive classroom. In fact, I doubt they should, and that's why this is an interesting question, right? It wouldn't be that interesting if it were just obvious what we should do. But it's pretty clear that a wide-ranging conversation about the ethics of online presence among professors And that's a conversation, by the way, that should include students, legislators, and the public. Just as a conversation about the ethics of bankers should include account holders, legislators, and the public. I'm as unhappy with the idea that faculty should be the sole commentators on the ethics of the faculty as I am on the idea that bankers should be the sole commentators on the ethics of bankers. No, I'm not. I'm not quite as unhappy, but you see the point. Appeals to academic freedom and constitutionally protected speech foreclose on this discussion. I'm not interested in whether people should get fired for this, that, or the other. I'm not interested in whether they should go to jail for this, that, and the other. I know other people might be interested in that. I'm not interested in what I should be fired for or go to jail for. I'm interested in what I am morally, what is the ethical thing to do of the many things that I will not get fired for or sent to jail for, right? As a professional. And I think we need a discussion about what is and isn't compatible with the role of a professor. And I think we need, philosophers can contribute to that. Okay, I've got a whole lot more to say, but I won't say it. Last thing is about the book. Some of these questions are discussed in the book. Some of them are just sort of raised. The reason I think that Noel asked me to give the talk was that, to our complete sort of amazement, one day last November, or October, we were contacted by the American Association of Colleges and Universities the Association of American Colleges and Universities to tell us that our book, to our complete surprise, had won the Frederick W. Ness Award for the book that contributed most to the understanding of liberal education last year. So our hope was that we would get philosophers to actually do some interesting work. We didn't bother to hope that anybody beyond philosophy might pay attention and read it, but if we had the energy to hope for that, we would have hoped for it, and it turns out that at least it appears that has come true. Questions, or will somebody else do it for me? I don't mind.
Yes, a bit of a leveler among the various disciplines are the learning management systems and the apparatuses, the technological apparatuses that go along with them, the online infrastructure that undergirds higher education. One particularly problematic part of this is the online testing apparatus, which shoves a webcam into students' faces very soon, and already in some universities have the students connected to a Fitbit or have keystrokes monitored and all that, for all sorts of obvious reasons, impersonation and all that. But what I'm thinking of are the various indignities that students are going through along this line. And what the university is actually teaching them. Are we teaching students, do we trust you? Do you have the right to make the decision to cheat or not? I think that's a decision we should all have and not be, in effect, wired into computers. And just one note about business school professors. I'm giving a class on this at Wharton, an invited class at Wharton a business school on this topic next week. So there's a bit of enlightenment out there.
Oh, no, our business school requires that every business student take a philosophy class. So I was not biting the hand that feeds me. It's great that they do that, and I admire them for it.
But
and I'm glad to have their students. Yeah.
There's not a lot of outcry about that, and I'm shocked because it's integrated into all of these systems. And one even tries to find information about online cheating. One can abroad. It's huge in Sydney. It's huge in whatever the Guardian, Times, Higher Education Supplements. All of those are focusing on this, but not here. There's a dirty little secret that online cheating is completely rampant. And if I had been placed in that situation as an 18-year-old. I would have cheated. I mean, I would have wanted to have the dignity at least to resist in any way possible, probably through the masking tape, a way of just sticking a little piece of masking tape.
I'm not sure I agree. But it's that is an interesting problem that we ought to be thinking about. I just add, though, for students who don't know this, my students, I make them write a lot online, on Learn at UW, on Desire to Learn and Future on Campus. Just to be clear, Desire to Learn captures every single keystroke. So if you write Brighouse is an arsehole and then you delete it, it captures that. And somebody, not I should add, has access to that. I mean, obviously there are so many of you doing it. That's like, you know, if you tap the phone of everybody in the country, like, what was the point? But you know, there are interesting questions there.
Well, you talked about, you know, how there's definitely different abilities of professors at public universities and private universities, so Madison versus Harvard, for example, to exercise perhaps provocative, problematic speech like that, such as mentioned earlier. Are you saying that sort of really, really inflammatory speech should only be allowed or should be more present at, like, elite universities? Because I guess, I don't know if that's your point, but if that is, that seems like we're perhaps restricting the learning experience of being potentially offended to the most elite students.
I'm not saying anything bad. What should be what. And when I said almost that was at the tour we did at the American Association, McPherson pointed out to me that I'm the person who convinced him that the obligations of private universities are exactly the same as public universities. So it's not, I actually don't draw the distinctions. But I wanted to put it very forcefully. So I have the job of making sure that if a student is Muslim, if a student is a Trump voter, if a student is a Republican, if they're a Bernie voter, if they're a Christian, if they're an atheist, they, when they come into my room, they can learn from me. And that's true pretty much whoever they are. And that, I'm not convinced, and I know I have that job, and the state pays me for that job. There's a public institution paying me to do that job. And there are all sorts of very boring things that I have to do in order to make that happen, many of which I aspire to do and am not, you know, limited in my success at, right? One of the things that I think is a pretty surefire way of making it difficult for Muslims to learn from me is by talking online, if they get to see my tweets, about how, you know, all Muslims are terrorists or whatever, right? A pretty surefire way of making sure that somebody, and we have, there are a lot of such people on campus, people who supported the state of Israel during that period, or who are Zionists, pretty surefire way of making sure that it's going to be difficult for them to learn from me is by saying that anybody who supports the state of Israel right now is, I need to find the quote, but is an awful human being, right? Sure, that may be constitutionally protected. Saying it in class is really appalling, right? And, I mean, I have examples of things that I was really shocked and disappointed by some of the stories I heard from Trump-supporting students who came into my office in tears in the week after Trump was elected about things that had been said in classrooms, which were clearly not deliberately designed to alienate them, but that made it difficult for them to learn from and to feel trust in the people who were teaching them. Just as a left-wing student might feel that way if somebody had done a similar thing, excited about Trump winning, right? So I think it's a really hard, interesting question. I will say, how much should I reveal about myself? If this goes online, I don't know. I keep my cards pretty close to my chest. I did in the 2000, after the 2004 election, the day after the 2004 election, I got an anonymous death threat from a student who had been in my class because the student referred to something that I'd said in class on the Thursday, on the day after the election, assuming that I was a Bush supporter, right? Assuming, so it was a death threat from somebody, it was really, really unpleasant. And of course it was from some other email, right? It wasn't from their own email account then, I presume. If you send death threats, I've got a piece of advice. Do not send them from your own email. I've got another piece of advice, is don't send them. But, you know, just, it's really hard to, it's hard to know exactly what's right. If you go, okay, last thing on this, it seems to me that we want to have faculty who are publicly involved in policy making, in policy agitation, etc. So we want to have faculty, for example, who litigate around Roe versus Wade, or who, you know, on one side or the other. They may be very passionate about Roe versus Wade. I think it would be inappropriate for them in a classroom to, pretty much whatever they're teaching, to say to students, I expect you all, and this is an exact quote from a student who heard this, I expect you all, if Roe versus Wade is threatened, to protest and demonstrate in support of it. Right? Even if they would say that totally, obviously they should say that to their friends. Maybe they should say that to large crowds of people, but inappropriate in the classroom. I don't know where the line is. I don't know what's appropriate where. That's why, if I thought I knew that, I'd say, no, we don't need any philosophical work on it. Forget it. I've solved it. But I haven't. Unlike every other problem. Dr.
Okay. So you have talked about how educators should incorporate liberal arts education into professional preparation so that we would require business students to take philosophy class. But what do you think are the obligations for educators inside the realm of liberal arts education to prepare students for their career due to the job market for humanities is indeed more limited?
I think that collectively, we have a lot of responsibility. So any individual professor may not have a lot of responsibility, maybe that you really do because of your skill set or because of your the particular thing you're teaching, you know, you should just be focused on that. But collectively, so Letters and Science now has this career initiative. It's absolutely right that we have a career initiative and we should have a career initiative. But departments too should be thinking about it. They should be thinking about what, and even in many classes, one of the reasons I make my students write a lot is because otherwise they won't write a lot. And the truth is, if you don't write a lot, if you don't learn how to communicate with other people, and one of the reasons I make them engage with each other and talk with each other and talk with each other in and out of class, is because if you don't learn how to do that, you know, you'll get a job, but you won't get a career. You know, the market rewards, for good reasons, people who can communicate with people who are unlike them and can communicate concisely and precisely in writing and in speech. That's why Comm B is not enough. We need Comm B, but we need in our classes to make students talk to one another about material. Even at loss, you know, and the loss of that. So, you know, I could talk for 75 minutes, as you can tell, I can talk for a lot longer than that, very precisely about this, that, and the other, and you can all pretend to listen. And then we got lots of precision in the room, but not as much learning. I would rather have more learning at some cost of precision. But yeah, I think it's really important. I think it's always been important. I think it's a matter of not life and death. I don't mean life and death, literally. But I think if we don't take that very seriously in the next 10, 15 years, colleges of letters and science, and especially of letters and arts, are going to be really harmed. And society and the economy are going to be harmed, I think.
Thank you.
Eric.
So, well, there are certainly lots of ambiguities about sort of the ethical demands or obligations of professors. There are promotion and tenure systems that seem to be to implicitly endorse certain balances between how one spends one's time.
Yeah.
Is that, are those in a sense ethical claims, or are they at all related to the ethical ideas you're talking about?
Good. So I think of these ethical questions as sort of coming, if you like, at three different levels. So one level is what the state, or whatever the authorizing authority is, what that should do. So how should it spend its money, right? And how should it structure the university? Should it, for example, be pressuring us to change the balance? So as I see it, the incentives in our particular institution and in our sector of higher education are to do research. That's how you get job offers, that's how you get raises, that's how you get respect from people who you see for more than 16 weeks at a time, right? And there's pretty much no incentive to do anything else other than be not too bad at your teaching. Not so bad at your teaching that people are constantly complaining about you. I mean, I think that's the way the incentive. I think that's a ridiculous set of incentives for a public institution. I also think it's ridiculous for a private institution, just to get back there. And I think that it would be entirely right for legislators to try and pressure us to change that some. So that's what the statute. Then you have the institution itself. The institution has some freedom, not loads of freedom, but some freedom about how to change that. And I think the institution, the institution leadership should change that, even without pressure from the legislature. Then assume that the legislature is doing roughly what it has done. I mean, in our sector, assume that the nothing changes at the institution level. Then you, as a professor, still have a whole lot of choices to make, right? You have a choice of, will I spend time with this student who I think will learn a lot, or who I think will has various needs that will be met, or should I spend that time writing another paper, or you know, helping to develop another paper, or whatever? And should I teach an extra course that I won't get paid for because I've got this? This happened to me last spring. In the fall of last year, a student came to me and she said, "I'm really mad at you." I said, "God, this is bad." And she said, "I'm really mad at you." I said, "Why?" She said, "You're not teaching any classes in the spring that I can take, and I'm a senior, and I'm going to graduate." And I sort of just one of those things really through. I thought, "Oh, you might teach another course." I said, "If you can get me a group of people together who are willing to work hard at reading some stuff on higher education, we'll do a 2-credit course." And she did it. Right, she got. I think it was really fun. There were about 7 or 8 of them. For them, it was the one really intense experience they got. I didn't get paid for that. Now I've got tenure. I wouldn't have done that before tenure, and I wouldn't advise my colleagues who don't have tenure to do it before tenure. I think that would be wrong of me to advise them to do that. It wouldn't be wrong of them to do it. But that's a choice, and I'm not trying to get credit. Like, it was really fun. I'm not, and if it hadn't been fun, maybe I wouldn't. If I hadn't anticipated it, I probably wouldn't have done it, so I'm not. But that's it. There are micro-level decisions that you're making all the time, and it's not good enough to say, for most of us in our regular lives, we don't say, "Oh, I need an incentive to do something good." We think, "No, I better do the best thing I can within the constraints of the incentives and the punishments that are there." And so an individual level ethic, I think, should apply to us. So the thinking is different at the different levels. And what you do within one level, to some extent might depend on, and to some extent might be completely independent of what gets done at the other levels. Right?
You talked about the importance of being accommodating to students with a variety of backgrounds, but taking that a step further, do you feel like there's an obligation to try to improve civility in the public discourse given the rise in polarization and the kind of echo chambers on the left and right that students are dealing with?
What do you think, Paula? So, my colleague Paula McAvoy has written. My other visual aid would have been her book if I hadn't walked out the house without it this morning. The Political Classroom, which is about K-12 education, and it's precisely about the ways in which teachers in K-12 education, high school social studies in particular, cannot facilitate civility. I don't know. All of my inclinations are to think, yes, that's what we should be doing. We should be trying to ensure that people can talk and learn across difference. And there's a quixotic part of me that thinks, even if that's a totally ridiculous thing that will never, the structure that we live in does not reward that kind of behavior. The structure that we live in tells you not to behave like that. Right, and there's no reinforcements in the media, right? In the media, you do not have. I listened to a radio broadcast, the BBC radio broadcast, in which they bring together every week. They bring together four politicians from different perspectives and different parties. And last week, there was a Labour peer, a Labour lord. That doesn't mean what it sounds like. It means a female Labour lord, and a Conservative former minister, Dominic Green. And what was so vivid and interesting was they were talking about Brexit. That was fun. What was so vivid, and she made so clear, was how much she admired him, right? She admires him as a person. She has lots of disagreements with him, lots of agreements with him. But it was quite a vivid thing, like, oh, you know, this, you know, he's done this, he's done that, and the way he does things, obviously, if he were in charge of this, he'd do it well. And where is that on American radio or American TV? Nowhere. That kind of civility, that kind of understanding that people learn across difference. So you don't have any of that, then it seems a bit quixotic to be trying to provoke it in your classrooms, but I feel like my life has been quixotic, so why not just carry on? Yeah, I think as an institution we have a duty, but whether it's achievable, I don't know. And if it's not achievable, maybe we should be doing other things.
How do you think about this idea of inclusiveness and welcoming people having different ideas with the idea that sometimes people's ideas and opinions are incorrect, wrong? I read a blog recently that likened some of this discussion, saying, well, if you're a geographer, some people comes in and says the earth is flat, that's wrong. You can't let that opinion go on in your class or be spoken at your institution. I don't think all of our debates are that stark, so how do you adjudicate between kind of fact, alt-fact, opinion, ideology, that space?
That's one of the things where I think we don't do a great job of learning how to teach well. That's an example of something which I don't know the answer, because I think it takes an enormous amount of skill, some of which can't really be explained. But which can be learned and can be observed. In getting people, so one thing I teach contemporary moral issues, I teach applied ethics to people for whom, most of whom, it's the only philosophy course they're ever going to take. And one of the things that's important is to make sure that they feel able to articulate what they think, right? And what also I need to do is I need to get them into a space where they are engaging in reasoning with other people who disagree with them. That means, for example, making sure that people who disagree with them can speak. And it means creating an environment in the room where the inter-giving of reasons is not experienced as defense. You know, there isn't defensiveness and hostility, but there's common exploration. How do I do that? Probably I'm okay. You know, I mean, how good am I at that? I don't know how good I am. I know I'm really confident that I'm better than I was 15 years ago. I'm really really confident I'm better than I was 25 years ago. But I think that I could have gotten better quicker with better professional development experiences and, you know, more work and more of a professional ethic, more of an understanding that that was my job. Some things, you know, am I the right person to challenge somebody when they're wrong? Well, it depends. Like, if they can learn from me, maybe I am. But if I... So I'd give you, this is a sort of reverse example, if you like. So when we talk about the morality of abortion in our class, and my experience is that the kids who are pro-choice, a large number of kids who are pro-choice, they could last 2 minutes in the room with me, but no longer, right? Because they've never heard any sensible argument against abortion, right? A lot of the kids who are pro-life, like, they can last longer. Because they've heard all the arguments in favor, they've heard the arguments. That's because of the institution they're in. It's because they're in a minority of about 25%. They came here knowing what it would be like, right? I'm sure it would be exactly the other way around if we were in at all somewhere, right? Where the pro-life kids haven't thought about it and the pro-choice kids probably have. My job is to make them think it through and to give them try and develop a sense of what are good reasons and what are not good reasons. If you go into a geography class and say the earth is flat, I wouldn't want to spend a lot of time on it. But I also wouldn't want to completely dismiss, have you looked? I've looked. And it looks bloody flat to me. And I'm not going to tell people, I know it looks flat in this case. Some people just have totally bizarre beliefs. The British, absolutely normal for totally sane seeming people to say things like, I mean, honestly, people who are friends of mine, they say things like, oh, you know, the Queen, I mean, it's such a hard job, you know, she does it so well, and you think, you're talking about a monarchy. Yeah, well, you know, it's better than having a presidency. I mean, look at them over in the US. You know, well, I can't quite see that. These are totally sane people who will defend the monarchy. Why? Because they live in an environment in which that's not regarded as lunacy. You know, and there are things that you believe that are also lunatic, and you believe because you live in an environment where they're not. For example, you probably don't even like cricket. That's because we live in an environment where, you know, people are completely oblivious to the one. But you know, education is education. It's getting people to learn how to, you know, learn real things and learn how to think, but not just tell them you're wrong. Because this is what they do if you just tell them they're wrong, is they think, okay, I know exactly what he wants me to say, and I'll say it. And it breeds a kind of cynicism, and it does not help us in our mission.
One of my favorite chapters in the book, Harry, is by Lionel McPherson.
Who is not related to Michael McPherson.
And it is closely tethered to the animating purpose of the book, which is about moral justice and so on. And Lionel states early on that mainstream institutions of higher education, which have a, U.S. have an orientation, a valid orientation, which is white and secular, are often thought of as liberal bastions. At the same time, he goes on to say, mainstream institutions of higher education have hardly led the way regarding social justice. In fact, he goes then on to say, one last sentence, historically white colleges and universities have largely failed to acknowledge, let alone to rectify, their complicity in racial injustice. Your reactions to that proposition and your thoughts, if any, with respect to how, to the extent that it exists, it should be addressed, including at public flagship universities like UW-Madison.
So one of the things he talks about in detail, quite rightly, is GI Bill, which the GI Bill essentially created the modern post-World War II university, and the GI Bill was, not deliberately, but the military was racist, the society was racist, the GI Bill worked out in a deeply racist way, and all research universities, but also others, they have been complicit because they accepted the GI Bill. It's not like it would have been better if they hadn't. I mean, maybe as a whole, if they'd all said no, but, you know, any particular institution wouldn't be better. Of course, we are in some ways beneficiaries and in some ways not of, I mean, we take the money of people, you know, we get endowment from people who are as rich as they are because of racist and other injustices in our society. He's a Tufts, which is, I would say the sort of elite private is worse than a good deal of the elite public, though I'd sort of count some of the elite publics as being more like private institutions. I would not count us that way. No, I think that's absolutely right. And then there's a big question about then what you do, and that's why we want to, thinking through exactly. You have to understand the analysis in order to sort of think through about what to do in the light of it. But yeah, exactly what we should do, I think it's not as clear.
Do we have time for it?
I don't know. I have to go in about 5 minutes.
I would like to ask a different kind of question about the substance of the articles, of the essays. And I was very much, I read some of them. Particularly, I want to point to the one about the support of the humanities by Bertram, as an aside, who happens to be at the University of Bristol where I got my liberal arts education before you were born.
And before
he anyway, was. Anyway. Bertram pays a lot of attention as to the value of humanities. And he quotes or he refers profusely to Martha Nussbaum, who also wrote a great deal about her latest book, Not for Profit, Why Democracy Needs the Humanities. And he seems to think that she expects too much, he says. The other thing, however, in support of the humanities, and I think in other in liberal arts, in other chapters, I noticed, there is more emphasis, they are useful for instrumental purposes.
Yeah. Yeah.
They never, however, talk about they are also useful for a flourishing life.
Yeah.
In your interpretation, Harry, of a flourishing life, you say somewhere, if I quote you correctly, in your other excellent book on education, the key place in this book, in your book, is that the central purposes of education is to promote human flourishing. And I understand the word flourishing is more than just getting a job. Is in the Aristotelian meaning, as you often quote, of eudaimonia, you know, the good life. And I miss that in the book, the value of the humanities. What also Martha Nussbaum also talks, and she plays, I was very much intrigued by Martha Nussbaum also, that she refers to Socratic pedagogy in her book as very significant. What are your comments regarding that?
Okay. So I'm not going to talk about Socratic.
It's a big question.
Yeah, it's a big question, but I can. So I think you're absolutely right. The quote's great. I think the purpose of education is to support flourishing life in a roughly Aristotelian.
But what do we mean by flourishing life?
Yeah. So that I'm not going to spend 2.5 hours sort of going into. I do think so. I agree with you completely. I think it's a mistake to think that the only or even the main reason why we should teach the humanities is because of its role in democracy. I don't even think it's necessarily needed as much, or its role in the economy. Though I do think it matters a lot for the economy,
of course,
and people's economic sort of capacities. But one of the things we should be doing, and I think this is something we should be doing in higher education, not just in the humanities, but in our teaching more generally, and maybe outside the classroom, in our interactions with students, the way we structure our daily interactions with students, and we should be thinking about what is the optimal way of ensuring that there are two sides to it. One is they enter the world in a way that we've helped equip them to flourish, but also they enter the world in a way that we've equipped them to contribute to the flourishing of other people. And especially elite universities, which we are, you know, our students have a special duty in an unjustly unequal world, not just to think about their own flourishing, I think that matters a lot, but also to think about how they can contribute to the flourishing of other people, and especially of other people who are less advantaged than they are.
So, wonderful talk, Ariane. This is just a comment that might be a good place to wrap things up. I was thinking what we're talking about. There's an American, 20th century American novelist, Peter DeVries, who's a satirist who has one of his characters, think referring to Socrates. Although the unexamined life may not be worth living, the examined one is no damn bed of roses either.
I like the reference.
Yeah, I do agree with that.